right now. Who do we have here? Starting on my right.
Okay. Hi, I'm Adrian Esposito, Executive Director of Citizens Campaign for the Environment.
Good evening, Kevin McAllister, founder and president of Defend H2O.
Hello, everybody. I'm Louise Harrison. I'm with Save the Sound, and I'm the outreach coordinator for the Preserve Palm Island campaign.
A razzle dazzle applause. Once again, if you want to ask a question, raise your hand, and Will give you a question.
I'm Louise Zeldin. It's great to be here with all of you. What an amazing turnout. I'm sure we're going to be talking about a lot of really important issues this evening, so really looking forward to that. I have been serving for the last 21 months representing the 1st Congressional District of New York, a very unique district, one that is almost completely surrounded by water. We love Long Island, and it is really a privilege and honor to be able to represent it. I grew up here on Long Island, born and raised. I went to school, college, law school up in Albany, the Army ROTC, 4 years active duty in the Army. Then I've been in the reserves for the last 9, where I currently serve with the rank of major. I served for 4 years in the New York State Senate, representing the 3rd Senate District before the 2014 election. There are a lot of really important issues in Washington, D.C., and I've really enjoyed working on issues related to our national security, growing our economy, fighting for our veterans and first responders, improving our infrastructure and our healthcare and quality of education, our schools. Tonight, we'll have an opportunity to focus specifically on the environment. I know you're all here because you love Long Island. You care about the future of Long Island for our kids and grandkids, and I look forward to your questions. And thank you to the League of Conservation Voters for hosting us and for all of our families.
Adrian, you're on. Good evening, Congressman. Our first question is that Long Island is a coastal community, as you well know, and we are very sensitive to the adverse impact of climate change. New York State has made a commitment to achieve 50% of our energy goals to come from renewable energy by the year 2030. So the question is, how will you, as a member of Congress and our representative in lovely Long Island, what will you do to help us advance good renewable energies, including wind and solar? And part B is, do you support the offshore wind farm that is proposed for 30 miles off of Montauk?
So there are a few different components to the other question. Our climate has been changing. It's something that is very important for us to tackle. We can be better stewards of our air, of our water, of our land. Regardless of where you are on certain issues where people might disagree with us, I think everyone would agree that it's important to have clean air and clean water. Here in the 1st Congressional District, where we set goals at the local community level, towns and counties and the state, whatever we can do to be supportive to meet those goals are important. One area that I've been specifically focused on the most is with regards to the investment of ARPA-E funding, the research mission that takes place at Brookhaven National Lab, Stony Brook University, pursuing alternative energy. In order for us to have the ability to reduce our reliance on fossil fuels, that pursuit of clean and green energy, that technology is key. Here on Long Island, in order for us to pursue that future of a Long Island economy, if we want to create good-paying jobs, part of that engine of that economy, I think, is to pursue that opportunity that's available for alternative energy. We have opportunities as we look at Palm Island and Cold Spring Harbor Lab. You can branch out further from just that mission as we currently see it in Brookhaven National Laboratory and Stony Brook for additional opportunities elsewhere. As far as the offshore wind, there is a great opportunity there. It's important as you're going through the permitting process and the vetting process that you have local control. For me, I care very strongly in supporting the South Fork and the east end of Long Island and making that determination of what the east end wants. and ensuring that if anything did go forward, that the benefit is being seen here on the east end of Long Island, as opposed to that benefit moving off of our regional autonomy. It's certainly ensuring that plans are mitigating all negative environmental impacts, because the whole purpose of creating any type of wind project is to reduce reliance on fossil fuels and to find new ways to take care of our energy needs. So it's something that I first and foremost have been focused in on local control of the permitting process that's in place. But as that process goes forward, to be secure about it, if it does go forward, is ensuring that the East End is getting its needs, demands, and wishes in the way it's being implemented.
Thank you.
Please, Kevin McAllister. Congressman, I know you've been tuned in on the Fire Island and Montauk Point cultural plan. Having attended four of the meetings, a theme that has resonated from the communities, there's concern that the Corps is not factoring in sea level rise in both their design and planning. An example of that would be the Lower Mastic Peninsula, where the prescription drawn is to elevate homes, raise roads, and actually dike around the area. That will have little effect on coastal inundation from rising groundwater. And with sea level certainly projected to be worse, I'd like you to share your thoughts on coastal retreat as an appropriate alternative in some of these flood-prone areas.
Great question. When I came into office, the Fire Island Montauk Point Plan was funded at just over $600 million. We've gotten that increased to $1.16 billion. The draft general reevaluation report is coming out of the public comment period closing tomorrow. So if anyone has any last-minute thoughts, you can still email or stick it in the mail tomorrow, hopefully it's postmarked. What we've seen throughout the public comment period has been in different communities and in individual meetings, outreach, the letters, emails that we get. There are components of the project that people are super thrilled about, they can't wait for it, and there are other areas where suggestions have been provided to make the plan better. Downtown Montauk, for example, there was a emergency stabilization project that took place. And the original draft general reevaluation report didn't have enough sand in the initial construction or the four-year replenishment. So working with the Army Corps and working with the town, all indications are that the final general reevaluation report is going to include that increase in the amount of sand that is necessary in order for that project to work. I live on the Mastic Peninsula, so that one's personal to me. As far as the feedback that has been provided there, actually, a lot of people, because the proposal was put out prior to design or engineering. And what a lot of the feedback we've gotten, the Army Corps has received, is that they're going to have to make adjustments to that project. We need to have more natural, as far as coastal resiliency goes, more of a natural barrier. What I've seen through the sandy recovery, either as a state senator or during my time now in Congress, is that in order to take advantage of buyout options, take advantage of home raising options, it's important that the local community rallies behind that solution. What we have seen in some communities is where the community rallies behind having some type of a buyout option. In Mastic Beach, it's actually been pretty split in the community. There are many who want it, others don't. There's a concern that if you buy out some of this land, some of the local taxpayers, I don't live in the village, but those who live in the village of Mastic Beach concerned about the property tax impact. That has to do kind of maintenance, the property maintenance, who's going to be in charge of that maintenance. But Mastic Beach, because of its position below sea level, when you get hit by a storm, the Smith Point County Park, those dunes, when those are lost, you have literally over 50,000 residents in the Mastic Peninsula. And it's very easy for very quickly those homes to be flooded. That's where I spent that night with Sandy, was at the Mastic Beach Fire Department. We were doing rescues from the second story windows very quickly. Houses, the first floors were gone. So I think part of the solution as far as the final general reevaluation report for the Fire Island Montauk Point Plan will have changes for the Mastic Peninsula. And I think some of what's been proposed will need to get changed for the design and engineering concerns and measures.
Thank you.
Good evening, Congressman.
Many people have
ideas on the future use of Vermont. As for everybody, as you probably know, it's off the east end of the North Fork in Southville. And one idea is for the federal government simply to just continue owning the island and not to sell a national treasure. If Plum Island is successfully retained in federal ownership, what would be your vision for its future use and its management, including its existing infrastructure and including natural resources protection? What would your vision look like, and could you provide details?
Well, currently you have great research infrastructure there on Plum Island. By the way, having had the opportunity to visit Plum Island, what's amazing, you feel like you're thousands of miles away from it. As you're taking a tour, you see seals and beautiful beaches and cliffs. You'd think that you were literally on a vacation thousands of miles away from it. But as far as the investment that's been made in the research infrastructure, and it's very modern, I believe it should be continued to be used for a research mission, for us to continue to have a good paying jobs there on Plum Island to do something very productive. We would have to find that interest, whether it's coming from a university, local nonprofit, company, figure out a way to have a good research mission for Plum Island. But 90% of Plum Island's undeveloped, and it should stay that way. And on top of that, I want all Long Islanders, people visiting Long Island, to have the same experience that I have. For any of you who have visited Plum Island, there should be public access. To some extent, they have to figure out as far as the long-term use of Plum Island for more people to be able to enjoy this treasure that's so close to home. I have led this effort since day one when I came to Congress. It was 11 years ago that the decision was made that the mission that was at Plum Island will get moved to Kansas. And 3 years after that, there was a federal law that was passed that said that Plum Island needs to be sold to the highest bidder. We got rolled twice. And now in order for us to get what we need to protect Plum Island, I introduced H.R. 1887, which is legislation to save Plum Island, working with colleagues, Republicans and Democrats. We got this bill out of committee for the first time. We got the bill passed on the House floor unanimously. And we also got a legislative proposal that's signed, attached to the Interior Probes Bill, so if there's a minibus before the end of the year, language in that bill says no funding in this appropriation can be used in pursuit of that 2008 law. I don't know of a single member of Congress who's opposed to this. What I'm hopeful for is that after this election, what's really important that in the Senate, that our senators here, both in New York and Connecticut, have spoken to Senator Ron Johnson, who chairs the Homeland Security Committee. He's aware of it. He called me right in the middle of his campaign. God bless him for taking time to talk about Plum Island, nowhere near Wisconsin. But November, December, next month, or the one after, they have to pass this legislation in the Senate in order to save Plum Island.
Thank you.
Avery.
Okay. I know this would be unusual coming from me, but this is actually a softball question. You and the same for your partner. As we all know, Long Island Sound is an estuary of national significance. The latest economic studies illustrate that it generates between $17 and $37 billion per year into our regional economy. And yet, it is the least funded estuary of national significance in the federal budget. This year, good news is Congressman Israel took up the funding torch and proposed $10 million for the first time to be assigned to Long Island Sound. You supported that, it passed, but you don't have any budget from the federal government. Will you make a public commitment to continue to champion and take up that torch, the $10 million for Long Island Sound, for that EPA office, so we can help restore and continue the progress?
It's a great question. I actually co-sponsored the Long Island Sound Restoration and Stewardship Act with Congressman Israel, which is for a lot more than $10 million in annual funding. And that is something that Congressman Israel is retiring at the end of the year. And I look forward to reintroducing that legislation in January and continuing that fight. As part of the presidential budgets, what we've seen in my 2 years being in Congress is that when the executive budget has been offered, we have seen funding cuts proposed for the Long Island Sound. Whatever is the next administration, come the next time the executive budget is proposed, we can't see that reduction proposed right out of the gate. That's not a strong starting position. As was mentioned, Long Island Sound is it's an estuary of national significance. We here in the 1st Congressional District have two estuaries between the Long Island Sound and the Conic Bay. Congress did fund $26.5 million for the National Estuary Program. I also would love to see, looking at the waterways of the South Shore of the 1st Congressional District, possibly expanding the National Estuary Program, and so that all the other estuaries don't feel like they're going to lose anything, that means that we would have to appropriate a little bit more money. But I believe, I grew up on the Great South Bay, and there's a lot of waterways in the South Shore that should be part of that. The Long Island Sound is also one that has a very controversial future as it relates to Connecticut's dredge waste. It's important for those who are in Connecticut to know that Long Islanders have no issue at all with Connecticut being able to do their dredging projects. We just know that there's much better use for that dredge waste than open water dumping. Fortunately, is there going to be a question on?
Yes, that's okay, you go ahead.
There's currently the plan of the EPA is that the eastern dump sites are scheduled to be phased out in December. We have held multiple press conferences and have been fighting hard, championing the effort to ensure that the EPA continues to honor that pledge to phase out the eastern dump sites by 2 months from now. Now, as far as the western dump sites, while we were at these press conferences, I decided to chime in. I might have been the only member of Congress who has chimed in on this one so far, but while we're at it, the EPA should also phase out open water dumping for the western dump sites, because right now the plan is for 30 years. I believe that they should reduce that to 10. I don't know if there's a forum that gets held for the 3rd Congressional District. Hopefully, you're able to get their members on record as well in order to build additional support for that. But we have been working hard to ensure that the eastern dump sites continue to be phased out as scheduled in December. There are a lot of other ways to use the dredge waste that, while the EPA might say it costs, that it saves money for the open water dumping, but when you look at the big picture and the amount of investment that gets made in many other ways, including state-level investments, states investing in the Long Island Sound, it actually doesn't make more financial sense to continue the open water dumping.
The Environmental Protection Agency was established in 1970 through the leadership of President Nixon to consolidate the agency into research, monitoring, standard setting, and enforcement activities to ensure environmental protection. Since then, the EPA's activities have become a lightning rod in Congress. And I guess I'd like to ask your thoughts on your perspective of EPA. Should it be strengthened? Should it be downsized? Again, it seems to be under siege, and certainly an advocate that is relying on federal law for protecting water and air, its existence is quite important relative to its strength.
Well, and a lot is going to depend on who the next administrator is, what the next administration's policy and vision is for the environment, for the EPA. There are two areas being in Congress for just 21 months I see a lot of room for improvement. Is one with regards to the relationship between the EPA and Congress, oversight of any agency, of all agencies, that's one of Congress's role is to oversee the implementation of federal laws and the manner in which appropriations are being spent, all agencies. And I believe that that relationship should improve. As far as policy proposals, almost every president has utilized executive orders. If you look at the current president, the last one, Republicans, Democrats, probably through the life of the EPA, executive orders have been signed by different presidents. But what is very important is that when a proposal is being signed off on that really should be passed by going through Congress, by going through the legislative process, I think that's what's caused additional tension, is that certain policies are being implemented through the EPA that should be vetted out statutorily through the legislative process, through the committees of jurisdiction, more than what we're seeing right now. This is one area that hopefully in the future, regardless of whoever the next president or the one after that one, the next Congress or the next Congress after that, I'm telling you that in order to improve that relationship, the oversight function needs to be more productive, and instead of signing so many executive orders, it's bringing the case to Congress, working with the committees of jurisdiction to try to get these bills passed.
As we all know, Long Island is rich in beaches. Maintaining access to safe and open beaches is critical for the Long Island economy. As you know, funding and oversight for beach water quality monitoring comes from the EPA through the Beach Act. Funding for the EPA and the Beach Act program have been under attack in recent budget negotiations. What is your position on funding the EPA and the Beach Act? If you do not support funding for EPA and the Beach Act, how can the federal government help keep beaches clean, open, and safe for swimming and recreation?
My whole approach to issues related to our beaches, dredging, erosion, it's been a very parochial approach to this. When I come into office and I have a meeting in South Hold where local residents are talking about the need to finalize the Hashimama Cove study, and you're talking to homeowners who don't have a beach anymore behind their house, is figuring out how to get that study done, get it funded, finalized, approved, and right now the Hashimama Cove project, which just came out of the public comment period, is on pace for a 2017 design construction, so that people now have their beaches. And by the way, this isn't just about protecting sand that is in front of someone's house. In many cases, and maybe Hashimama Cove is the greatest example of where you're protecting a county road, a lifeline to hospitals, a lifeline to nursing homes. So there's the economic piece of the Long Island economy, Long Island coastal economy, but it's also for many people, for business, for residents, it's how they survive. And for people who use some of these roads as their lifeline to east-west, the main east-west corridor, from that standpoint, it's incredibly important as well. The Army Corps, I serve on the House Transportation Infrastructure Committee. I don't know if there's another congressional district in the United States that has more Army Corps projects right now than we do. And what I have been working really, really hard on with my team is ensuring that all of these projects move forward, and whatever we have to do, whoever needs to get rolled to get any of these projects done. I don't care if you're standing in the way as a Republican or a Democrat. I don't care if you're a member of leadership, if you're a committee chair, you're a ranking member, whatever we need to do to get these projects done. Now, on the South Shore, we spoke about the 5 miles of Montauk Point plan. There may not be, that's about $500 million more money that's coming from the Coast Protection District than when I got there. And that's money to protect our barrier beaches on the South Shore. But you know, we have a lot of other issues as you work your way around. So about the Long Island Sound, at Royal Taconic Estuary. And there, if we went into detail on all these different Army Corps projects that we have been working on, it's just filled with a whole lot of progress over the course of the last 21 months under our
Thank you. You're up again.
Congressman, you already addressed my last question, which is on the dredge materials management plan, and thank you for your support on that and opposing it. We appreciate that. So I'm going to go back to the EPA question at the risk of making us here nervous. You know, one candidate running for president has publicly stated he wants to abolish the EPA. I'd like for you kindly to comment on whether you agree with that or not. And I understand what you said, that you want to make them more accountable to Congress. I get that. But I will say that I've seen many congressional members over my 30 years of working in the environmental arena who use political science rather than biological science or public health science to make determinations. And the EPA is really an agency that is supposed to incorporate science-based decisions based on public health and environmental protection for now and in the future. So can you commit to wanting to keep the EPA and understand and support their science-based decisions?
Yeah, my position has been, and continues to be at risk of repeating my last answer to this question from Kevin, is the need to improve the agency, which is very different than advocating to eliminate it. And I don't want to repeat anything that the vision of the next administration, the vision of the next administrator, I would suggest on their side that the best way to improve the EPA is to strengthen that relationship with Congress. And there are many members of Congress willing to sit down and work together. And I would love to be a part of that.
Thank you. Questions that he can answer relatively, because I do want to get some questions.
Our region's surface water and groundwater is under siege with nitrogen pollution. What do you perceive the role of the federal role in corrective actions? The second part of that, some years back, approximately 20 years ago, the EPA directed states to move into numeric nutrient standards, metrics where we can define water quality health. There are, of course, implications to the agricultural industry as well as development industry. But I'd like to know your feeling on the federal role in nutrient, curtailing nutrient pollution.
Congressman, can you make sure you speak into the mic so people in the back
can
hear you?
Okay.
The mic
may
not be open. I think it's
just his mic.
I don't think it is.
All right. Well, I'll just project a little more. It's an important question that Kevin just asked with regards to water quality. All different levels of government have different roles to play as it relates to water quality. And there's also a lot of diversity depending on the specific challenge. In some areas, we're talking about ocean and bays. In other areas, you're talking about lakes. In some areas, the jurisdiction of upkeep and dredging might be of the state or federal government. In other areas, it might be more local, where the village mayor of Patchogue, Paul Ponieri, comes and asks for assistance with a lake or a creek. Or it's multiple levels of government working together to protect Carmen's River and Forge River, which I live between. Now, in our area on the Mastic Peninsula, the solution is, and by the way, as I said, it's a very diverse district. In the Mastic Peninsula, right now we're getting hundreds of millions of dollars to upgrade our sewage infrastructure. Money that came from the federal government through the state government to the local area for Shirley Mastic, Mastic Beach. That money's desperately needed in there. That type of infrastructure makes a lot of sense. There's an important federal role where there is a community that can benefit from having that type of an upgrade as it relates to sewage infrastructure. There are also policies as you get to the most local level as it relates to stormwater runoff, nitrogen loading, algae blooms. By the way, you would talk about algae blooms. A lot of the best research that's being done right now is being done by great private groups, doing fundraising, taking a whole lot of initiative, making really fancy videos that are working and helping with their fundraising. Because there are areas like Georgia Pond and elsewhere where you can restore what Georgia Pond and other places like that once were, but it's not so much the federal government coming in and having it within their jurisdiction to save Georgia Pond. But whatever I can do to help, as I've tried to do in connecting people to other people who care about those issues. Forge River is one of the most polluted waterways, if not the most polluted waterway in New York State. I happen to, as I mentioned, live between the two, and cleaning up Forge River is part of it, but then it's also the long-term stability of Forge River when you have so much development. And development is a big issue, because when you have so much development along a waterway and people want their homes to, they want to have really nice lawn, maybe they don't have the right system in place so that when rain comes, the rain isn't coming into a gutter, and then the gutter isn't draining into rocks, and the rocks are going into the sand, and you're taking care of the stormwater runoff the way it should. In other areas, it's going right down the street, and you can see fertilizer and other things you do not want in your water supply. So part of that comes down to the individual stormwater level. But as far as the federal government goes, what I've found has been very diverse. There are aspects of the Fire Island to Montauk Point plan where we are using resiliency and the natural barrier, because you know, the Carbons River, for example, one of the best assets that are there when you compare it to Forge is that there isn't as much development along the water. You need to protect that. In order to save the Carbons, you have to protect the Carbons from more development.
I'm
so,
gonna ask to wrap this one so I can ask one more question.
That was a tough one though to answer very quickly. That's an important one. We have a very diverse district.
Well, this actually continues from what you were saying, so you can finish your thoughts on it, perhaps. Studies have shown that the country chronically underfunds sewage treatment plants and sewer stormwater infrastructure. Here in New York, as you were pointing out, that results in systems that are in desperate need of maintenance, repair, and upgrades. So while the state and municipalities bear the brunt funds provided by the federal government's Clean Water State Revolving Fund are a critical piece of the solution. Unfortunately, that fund is consistently targeted for cuts. So specifically, what is your position on funding the Clean Water State Revolving Fund?
I support it, and this has been an issue that I've now had the perspective on the state level and the federal level. One of the best ways to drive large sums of money is in our recovery effort related to Superstorm Sandy. We still have very much the attention of the feds as it relates to Sandy recovery. But if you want to finance a project for upgrading sewage infrastructure, there are many different components of it. If I was sitting down with a town supervisor or a local mayor, they were asking for advice. A part of this is low-cost financing through the Environmental Facilities Corporation. Parts of this is making an application to the Regional Economic Development Council, where funding was secured for Ronkonkoma, a hub, and for the sewage treatment plant there, as well as the Winans Rising project. Part of this has to do with public-private partnerships and the use of private activity bonds. Being able to not just create the 1.4 million new jobs that would come with it, but the $500 billion of capital by unloading all that private investment into these projects. I speak to local trades where they have a pension fund, where they're investing their pension fund in other people in other areas, sewage infrastructure projects. That money should be unleashed here in New York State through more public-private partnerships. So I would say that a lot goes into this. I mean, the Suffolk County government collects a fee to help with some of these costs as well. It also helps when the ask is for less. So when one area comes and they're asking for $20 million, it's easier to figure out how to get it done than when another area comes to you and they're asking for $400 million. But you know, a lot of this can start with the downtowns. And by the way, some of these areas too, you have local businesses, local individuals, homeowners who are willing to and able to help with that financing as well. So I think that's the best way to get the yes. The short answer to your question was just yes. But I just wanted to share some other important thoughts to it. Oh, by the way, the public activity bond piece, that's something that I had introduced through legislation in Congress. So legislatively, it's not just appropriations, but legislatively there are ways to help.
Thank you. So I have time at least for one question from the audience, maybe two. The issue of climate change has become severely politicized, which has distracted us from finding solutions. How can you work together across the aisle to find solutions? What might some of those solutions be?
Well, I have joined the Bipartisan Climate Solutions Caucus, and I give a credit to that there are local community leaders and groups that I've met with one 19 times. By the way, having a lot of meetings to figure out how to crack the code on this issue, because what I found, one of the reasons why it's so politicized is that the whole debate is about what's your position on climate change. And you never get past that part of the debate to talk about, so what are we going to do about it? What we need to figure out is whether you are a liberal Democrat or a conservative Republican, how do we reduce emissions? How do we make certain delivery methods cleaner? How do we get off of certain methods and pursue totally new ones? say there's 535 members of Congress. There isn't anyone that I dislike enough to say I wouldn't sit down with and talk to and work with to try to figure out how to make our air cleaner. I mean, one of the important goals, especially in building additional support, is figuring out how to pursue the smartest policy to get something done. And sometimes a strategy evolves. Someone puts out a proposal that would force, you know, or mandate some type of a change, and maybe you're able to work with the industry, the technology, the employer, and maybe one particular plant in a particular location can improve their practice. Maybe there's a way to help incentivize that. But that conversation you have to be willing to have, where you have 20 different ideas, 100 different ideas, and you're willing to listen to them all in order to find that bipartisan compromise. I have and continue to be very willing to have that conversation with anyone to see where we can find agreement and common ground.
Thank you. So, how about a minute wrap?
Yeah, there's a lot that we haven't had a chance to talk with. And one of the things I was really proud that got done is the Land and Water Conservation Fund was extended. The last Congress allowed the Land and Water Conservation Fund to expire. Working with Riverhead Town when they needed help to avoid a fish die-off in Meconic Bay to get the permitting done and get it expedited. When East Hampton Town comes and they want to do their dredging project between the Hog Creek and Gardner's Bay, working with the New York State DEC and the Army Corps of Engineers to get that all expedited and done. I have just been focusing a lot of this stuff. You know, it's not like there's a press conference that gets done or a press release every time, but you know, when there's a desire to, you know, get expedited emergency dredging permits for Meconic Bay, when Meconic Land Trust comes to you and says that their top priority is to extend the conservation easement tax credit, and at the end of last year we were able to get it permanently extended, and we were able to get the EPA to recognize Meconic Land Trust with their Environmental Champion Awards. It's been a privilege to represent this district on the local issues. We have a very unique district, 8 towns. You try to explain this district to people who aren't from here. By the way, to orient them to the district, you say, this is a district that has the Hamptons in it.
Oh, yeah.
And you're able to use that opportunity to tell them about the rest of the district, which is a beautiful place and an honor to represent. I strongly encourage all of you, if you're here, I'm sure you're going to vote on November 8th. Regardless of whoever you vote for, and obviously I'm here to ask for your support, whoever you vote for, I'm just looking forward to working with absolutely every one of you on November 9th, because that's what's most important, is when these elections are behind us, that we figure out how to work together to get stuff across the finish line. And that's most important for the area that we love here on Long Island. Thank you all for being here. Thanks for having me. Appreciate the questions.